Church. We'd like to invite you to our Central Leadership Summit Training at the Regional Training at Pomona Christian Life Church on February 10th from 9 a.m. to 3:30 p.m. We look forward to you signing up. You can sign up today in the lobby or with one of our leadership staff. Thank you, and stay tuned for more announcements.
Hi, my name is Robin from Neighborhood Community Church, and I'm here to tell you about our Wednesday night Neighborhood Nights. It happens at 6 p.m. here at the Neighborhood Church. We have the three F's. We have food, fellowship, and family. Come be a part of it. Volunteer if you'd like, or just come and enjoy the fellowship. Thank you.
Hello everyone, my name is Pastor Angelica Hernandez, and I want to personally invite the women to save the date for March 23rd, because that date is for the Spring Conference. And in this Spring Conference, the theme is crowned. And you're going to experience a day of renewal and refreshing. And the guest speaker is named Allie Jo Vasquez. She's the author of Armed and Victorious, 31 Days in the Armor of God. Because this is a year that we're going to be victorious. So if you want to be a victorious woman, sign up for this conference. March 23rd from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. It's going to be take place in Long Beach. The registration is $55, early registration, until February 14th. After that, it goes up in price. If you have any questions, please come and see me at the office.
Hello, everyone. This is Pastor Carlos Hernandez calling all men from Neighborhood Church. The time has come. It's the time to save the date. April 5th to the 7th, we are going to have our men's retreat. So I would like to have everybody save the date. And also, just to let you guys know, it's a $50 deposit to go. It is going to be in Pinecrest, and the title is Disciple. We're going to have Pastor Dave Ross and Pastor Tom Hamill bring it on. So you don't want to miss it. We want to see you there. So please make your arrangements to make your $50 deposit. Come see me after church or before church. Just give me a call. You already have my number.
Lastly, we'd like to invite you to our annual business meeting that will take place on February 25, 2024, after our Sunday worship service. So if you're a member, please make plans to attend, as it is an important meeting that you do not want to miss. Now, get ready to worship and praise our God. Yeah. Woo! Woo!
Thank you. The truth is still the truth. I didn't ask you, my sin was heavy. But chains break at the weight of your love. I needed shelter, I was an orphan. Now you call me a citizen of heaven. Abraham, and here goes the list. And when I feel
like, oh God, why me? I go with my word. I go with my word because I know he was true to them. He's going to be true to me. He's going to be true to me. And as long as I keep reading his word, every time I cry out, why? I go with my word. I go with my word and I find peace. I find peace and joy. How can I think like that, Lord? Why do I think like that? Because I have flesh. But in the spirit, as long as I stay in my word, the spirit. Father God, we come to you right now, Lord, and we pray for these tithes and offering. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Father God, for everything, Lord, for your son. And with this song that the worship is singing, because when he called my name, Tina, I came running, Father, with everything. Was it easy? No. Is it still easy? No. But as long as I got you, Father God, I know and I trust that all is good in your name, Father God. So right now, Father God, we pray for these tithes and offering, Lord. Thank you, Father God, for who you are, Lord. Bless it, multiply it. 2024, here we go. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you. I am so thankful today. I'm thankful every day. I give thanks. Can we just give thanks for a minute this morning? Can we shout, give a thanks? You're not excited about anything else. Be excited about God. Because He is amazing. And what He is doing in these last days, when you look up and you look around and you see what He's doing, it is absolutely amazing. We are on our way to church this morning. You know, a couple of weeks ago, we talked about, you guys remember what we talked about? Matthew 6:33, you guys remember that? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you. So we were on our way. I like to kid around with Karen. We're on our way. We were early this morning. We're picking up donuts. And there's this construction spot. And when you come up to it, we got a little bit of a ring there. And I want to talk about this volume. So yeah, that's good. So got this construction spot there when I'm getting off to get the donuts. And there's this little sign up there. And it says, no turn right on red light. No turning right on red light. So I'm looking at that thing, you know, and we're in a hurry to get to church. And I'm thinking in my mind, because everybody else is doing it, I'm thinking in my mind, I'm not going to do it.
That's right.
And so Karen looked over at me and she said, well, what do you think? We can just go through that, can't we? I know she was just kidding with me. You know what I did? You know what I did, Frank? I looked over at her and I said, get thee behind me, Satan.
Oh.
And she knew I was just kidding her.
That's right.
But that's the way it is, isn't it?
Yes.
We have things in front of us every day that we can compromise in, right? We can compromise in things every day. So when you think about the kingdom of heaven, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you. So when you think about the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God, they are referring to the same thing. When you look at both of them. And worry, remember a couple of weeks ago, worry's a big thing. People worried 2,000 years ago. They worried then, they worry today. So Jesus was giving us a warning when we read that scripture last week, a couple of weeks ago, and He was telling us that He cares about us, and less worry, less compromise, and the kingdom of heaven advances. Matthew 6:33. I want to read that to you here just as I open up today. And then we're going to look at something that maybe a lot of you have never heard this way before. But I want to read this in opening because this is what we talked about a couple of weeks ago. Matthew 6:25, I'll start. But therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more important than food, and the body more important than your clothes?
Amen.
Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow, reap, or store away in barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them.
Yes.
Are you not more valuable than they? Who of you by worrying can add a single hour to his life? And why do you worry about clothes? See how the lilies of the field grow. They do not labor or spin. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was dressed like one of these. If that is how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and tomorrow is thrown into the fire, will He not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. I need them. Say that. You need them. You need all of these things we just talked about. Every one of those things. But seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own.
Amen.
So they worried 2,000 years ago. We still worry today. And some people may say, well, I don't worry, but there may be other things that you don't think you're worried, but you're stressed out. You know, that's why a lot of people find themselves, when you think about, and this isn't about getting down on anybody for not coming to church, but that's what happens to people. People with the world is so powerful, and all of the input and all of the thought, it's so powerful that it can actually keep us from even going out and doing the very things that God tells us to do. One of the things he tells us to do, he says that we must keep gathering together like this. And I wonder, well, why should we gather together? Why can't we just stay home? Why can't we just do whatever we do and not even worry about church? Because if you don't do this, guess what will happen to you? You will become isolated. You will become like an island. And then all of the world, all of the worry, all of the things that Jesus is warning about, it's going to come upon you. And then you're going to find yourself compromising a little here, a little there, until now, in your own life, the kingdom of God does not advance very much. I'm excited about today because I know when we look at these things and when I read these things to you today, you're going to become excited like I am. The kingdom of heaven. And I'm looking forward to 2024. I want you to know, church, the fellowship hall has been cleaned out and tables have been set up. Can we get everybody excited in this place? Well, I get excited about the tables being set up. I'll tell you why. Because I have a vision of people coming all week and eating food with relationships being made. Can you imagine this? Just think about it. You say, well, that's change. I don't know. I can't even see that. I don't understand that. Well, just sit back. And well, no, don't sit back. Say, Pastor, I'm going to come down and help you build relationships with those people that are going to come here. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, they're going to come sit at these tables. We're going to, I don't know how we're going to do it, but God's going to do it for us. And we're going to get food, and it's going to be set out on those tables. And people are going to come in. They're going to know every afternoon there's going to be a meal for them. And you're going to see people coming from all over the city, and you're going to see them begin to build relationships with us. Do you think that by us just going out and just walking up to their door and saying, hey, we're right down the street, neighborhood church, come down and visit us. Do you think they're going to come down? They say, who are you?
Yeah.
But now they come in and sit down with you, and you have a meal with them. I can't wait, because we're going to get people, and we've been doing it on Wednesday nights. Charlie, haven't we?
Oh,
and
yeah.
We have several people brand new that have come from the neighborhood. They sit with us and eat, and then you get to sit down with them, and you get to talk with them one-on-one, and you get to find out a little bit about their life. And guess what happens? They say, hey, these are normal people. Church isn't so bad after all. People care about it. There's hope. There's light down there. Let's go and see what's happening. And then you're going to see a bridge that's going to be built from that fellowship hall. And you're going to see be a bridge that will be built over here so they can come in and enjoy all the love that's in this place. All the people that will care about them, we can pray for them. When they're in trouble, they can come to the altar. How many know that we're Holy Ghost people? Did you forget about the Holy Ghost? You know that the Holy Spirit is so powerful. If you know one dose of the Holy Ghost, I know that sounds like old school, but that's the way I talk. One dose of the Holy Spirit, and we will never be the same again. Now that you say, well, one dose is all I need, I keep getting doses every day. I get along with God, and I say, God, I need you. I need infilling. I need more and more. How many have done that this last week? If you said, I need more and more and more, because if you don't, guess what's going to happen? You're going to run out of gas. And I don't want anybody pushing me to the gas station, and I'm embarrassed to say I ran out of gas. And they've got to have somebody get behind me and push me to the gas station. I want to be the one so full, I want you to be so full, that it's just overflowing out of you.
That's right.
So that everywhere you go, the kingdom of heaven will be advanced, the kingdom of God will be advanced, you will just be flowing all. I'm walking out of the donut shop this morning. And you can't judge a book by the cover. And this guy comes in and he's standing there and I'm thinking, man, I wonder, is it just me that does that? I'm looking at the guy, Jan, I'm thinking, I want to know about this guy. I wonder what he does for a living. Does he have kids? Is he married? And, you know, what's he doing down here this morning buying donuts? And as I begin to walk out of there, realize that the kingdom of heaven is inside every one of you. You are full of the Holy Spirit. He lives inside of you. God lives inside of you. Jesus lives inside of you. So expect where you walk things to change, things to happen. And as I'm walking past the guy, you know what the guy says to me? I walk right by him. He says, Have a blessed day, sir.
Come on.
And so we don't realize what the power is that's inside of us. The kingdom of heaven is living inside of us, and it's advancing. When you see this parable that Jesus is going to talk to us about today, then you'll get more excited, as I get more excited, because as we are going into these next weeks, we're already having conversation with concerned families to be, listen to this, you guys, we have to still vote on it, the board still has to approve it, but to be a food distribution hub. I know that doesn't mean much to you. See, a food distribution hub to me, that means not a food bank where you get away. We're talking about a hub where people from all over the cities, from the high desert, from Rancho, California, all these places coming into this place right here because God gave us so much land out here that we need to now be a hub and we need to be an outflow of what God has given us. And then guess what happens? You don't have to wait till Sunday morning for somebody to show up and stand at the back door and say, I hope somebody new comes today so I can greet them.
Amen.
No, there'll be so many people that'll come out here. There'll be thousands of people that will come into this parking lot. And now any one of you, any day of the week, you can get up instead of watching TV and reruns and all that stuff. And what are they, novellas? Are they novellas? Instead of watching those during the day and being bored with life, get up and come down here and go out in the parking lot and start to meet some of the people that come in, and you might find that your life will change.
Amen.
So, you're going to hear more about that over the weeks. We're praying that we'll be able to get a forklift up here. We're going to have, this is what my vision is, that we're going to have a truck rolling, a semi-truck. They're getting down there hundreds and hundreds of pallets of food. When you see this video at the end that I'm going to show you, it's that spot, Pastor Lincoln Cooper, who's our friend, who wants to come up here, wants to partner with us, and I'm going to show you a video clip at the end, what just happened a few weeks ago on this site, because I want you to get the flavor of it. I want you to see it. I want you to get excited like me about filling the fellowship hall with people that don't even know Jesus, people that have no hope, people that are dying. They're sick inside. They get up every morning. They don't even know what the day's going to be. They don't even look forward to it. We can get them over there. We can begin to share what God has done for them. Wouldn't that be great?
Yes.
You can come up with the best testimonies to sit with them and tell them what God did for you. Right? We got a testimony, don't we? We can sit down with them and we can tell them what God did for us. If we don't know how to say anything else, we say, this is what God did for me. And the only reason why I'm here today is because what He did for me. He saved my soul. He healed my mind. He set me free. And now I am free forever. That's what I'm going to do to this community. Imagine what can happen. Now we're talking about the kingdom of heaven. Almost 220,000 people in San Bernardino. Imagine what we could do with what God has given us.
Amen.
Imagine with me just for a minute in the hands of God. Over 24,000 square feet of building here. Maybe you're not an architect, maybe you're not a builder, but a house, an average house is 1,200 square feet. Did you hear what? Over 24,000 square feet God has given us. Imagine what we could do with that.
Woo!
And then, that's not all. Have you guys seen how far it is from the gate out on Sierra Way to get to the church parking lot here? Do you know that we own all that land out there? Imagine what we could do with that. We're talking about the kingdom of heaven. We're not talking about neighborhood church kingdom. We're not talking about Mike kingdom or Charlie kingdom or Frank kingdom. We're talking about the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, which is going to grow and it's going to expand. Whether I get in and I said yes to God, it's what He's called me to do. Whether I do or not, did you know it'll still grow? Did you know it'll still advance? You cannot stop God from advancing. He's advancing all over the world right now. And He is not done yet. Do you believe He's not done yet? He's not done with me. He's not done with you. He is not done with the world. So, what is the kingdom of heaven like? Jesus, He uses parables to challenge and influence those that He spoke with. And I don't know You may have to help me. Okay. So Jesus spoke in parables. This is where today I'm hoping that some of this that we talk about, that you would think about one of these parables meaning one thing, but Jesus had two different meanings in this parable. So when you look at the kingdom of heaven, it affects everything that comes in contact with it. It affected me, it affects everybody. It is not a bubble. It is not excluding everyone who is not within. So we're not in a bubble here, folks. We are not in a vacuum here. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven is much bigger than this, and it doesn't exclude all the other people that are around us.
Amen.
Even the people that are not born again yet, the kingdom of heaven is still for them. Can I hear an amen on that?
Amen.
The kingdom of heaven is still for them. In the New Testament, there are 43 parables, and 13 of those tell us about the kingdom of heaven. And a parable is a story or a teaching device that Jesus used when he walked 3.5 years here on earth during his ministry. He told everyday stories that were easily visualized by the people that he was teaching. And he would tell these stories side by side with principles and concepts in the spiritual world. And you know many of the parables. I know that you've been taught them, you've listened to them on the radio, you've seen them on TV, you've read them out of the Bible, and you always see that there are these very complex spiritual truths. Karen and I were talking about one this morning. You know what she's teaching the kids upstairs today? That Jesus was a boy, but yet he was fully God. I said, that's complex. I said, I'm 68 years old. I'm still wrapping my mind around that one. But Jesus had what he was a master at telling stories side by side with all these things that the people could visualize and they could understand, because he wanted to teach them a spiritual truth that was much deeper than what he was sharing with them about the story that they could see. And the Holy Spirit working, I mean, Jesus was a master. He was God, fully God. So when he shared these stories, imagine today, Jesus said, he said, I'm going away, and it's good that I go away, because I have been given authority by God, my Father, to release the Holy Spirit. After I leave, I'm going to release the Holy Spirit to you, so you will not be by yourself. And he will be with you even to the end of this age. So the Holy Spirit's right now in this place.
Amen.
You feel him? I feel him.
Amen.
It is more than a feeling. It's something that runs so deep. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I want to do everything that God gives me with the power that he's given us with the word of God to advance the gospel. Are you guys ready? You guys are ready to advance the gospel in 2024? With you being the one that God is going to use. So the kingdom of God and the kingdom of heaven, in these parables, there were 13 of them. Now you're going to help me, but have to help me back there.
Sure, what?
This is not working today. So there were 13 out of the 43. It's very interesting. 13 out of these were kingdom of heaven parables. 5 of them dealt with agriculture. 4 of them dealt with money. There were 2 situations involving feasts. One was a fishing story. Do you guys remember the dragnet? Remember that? It was a fishing story. And then one of them used an example of cooking. So this is Jesus, the master, that is teaching these parables, using these as tools, as devices, to get the people to understand deep spiritual truths that they were totally blinded by. And here we have Jesus walking. The kingdom of, remember he was said the kingdom of God is near. Because he was the kingdom. He represented the kingdom, all God and all man. And he was walking all around for 33 years, walking around earth. And he was bringing the kingdom. He inaugurated the kingdom. He died on the cross so that his blood that was shed, now we all can now be citizens of heaven. You are now a citizen of heaven because you gave your life to Jesus. And now you are part of the kingdom of heaven. And by the way, Jesus said, a kingdom that will never end. So he's setting up his kingdom right now, and you and I, and he's advancing it, and it's not geographical, it's not buildings, it's not land, but it's people, one soul at a time. The kingdom advances, the kingdom grows. So that's why I get so excited when new people come in this parking lot, when new people come in there to eat, and just share a meal with them, I'm looking at them as, man, you may be a citizen of heaven pretty quick here. And then as soon as that happens, the kingdom of God advanced. It advanced, it's growing, and it's growing, and it's growing. And there's an end. You're going to see, if you hang with me over the next several weeks, you can see even by this parable I'm going to share with you today, that the kingdom of God was inaugurated by Jesus dying on the cross, and he went to heaven. And now the Holy Spirit's here, so now we can be regenerated. It's a big word. What it simply means is a miracle takes place. That the Holy Spirit comes upon you and you get a choice. And you say, I accept you, Jesus Christ, my Lord and Savior, and your sins are forgiven, and now you are a citizen of heaven, or you can reject it. And that is when the whole kingdom of heaven came to earth, and it's exploding. But you know what? It's not over yet. Because you know, the culmination of all of it happens in Revelation, and it says that there'll be a new heaven and a new earth. All of this gets burned up. It's all gone. And now all those people that accepted Jesus get to live with Jesus and the Father forever and ever and ever and ever. You think I don't get excited about that? Because this isn't all there is, folks. Some of you are saying, thank God this isn't all there is. That's why we need to give the people next door that are going to come in, we need to give them hope. And Jesus' teachings were easy for people of that time to understand. And they are adaptable to every culture and every age. I believe today that these parables, these teachings, just like they were, able to be understood by those that were listening to Jesus. Can you imagine? Jesus was teaching, he's speaking, and they're sitting there and they're listening to him and they're getting it. They're getting it. And he was such a master that these that we're now reading 2,000 years later, and they are still adaptable to today and for this age, and they still make perfect sense in the spiritual realm. Anybody with me today? Amen. We still can understand them, and they still have influence and power on us. So let's look at two parables that use different images to make these fundamental points about the kingdom. So the first one we're going to look at is this kingdom. You want to go ahead and... this battery must be dead, you guys. We'll fix that next week. See, everything is temporary here on earth, isn't it? Everything's temporary. So the kingdom is like yeast, and another word that's used is leaven. How many of you have ever heard the word leaven? Leaven. And a lot of you, you're going to see as I go through this today, that in my early years of Christianity, when I was taught, and even as a kid, I didn't think leaven was a good thing. A little leaven, we're going to look at some of that today. It wasn't a good thing, but you're going to find something different about this. He told them still another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took, mixed into a large amount of flour until it worked all through the dough. It's very interesting because if you do culturally look at this, this would be a lot of bread for us to make. But they would make up to, and it even talked about 3 pegs, 56 pounds. Can you imagine making 56 pounds of dough? So they ate a lot of bread back then. So they would take some of this that would be fermented. They would take seeds, and they would take these other products, and they'd actually set them aside. They let them ferment into bacteria.
Yep.
Wow. You ever made sourdough bread? You can get sourdough starter. So I get it. When I'm looking at this, I can really get it. I don't even have to be a baker. I don't have to be anybody that knows anything about the science about it. And I get it because of the way that Jesus taught this. So see how he was a master at taking something that was a natural thing, and he could take it and he could have deep spiritual truths that would be able to come out of what he would be teaching them. So if you want to go to the next slide, Jonathan. So in Luke, again, we hear, again he asks, what shall I compare the kingdom of God to? It is like yeast or leaven that a woman took, she mixed it into a large amount of flour until it worked all through the dough. So, leaven, you want to give me that next slide, Jonathan. Leaven was used in making bread. It was also used as a religious symbol. In the Old Testament, leaven was prohibited during the feast of the Passover. They were not allowed to use that. And in Matthew 16:12, I don't have that for you, but I want to read to you what Jesus said. He said, "Then they understood that he was not telling them to guard against the yeast used in bread, but against the teaching of the Pharisees and Sadducees."
Amen.
So he was saying to beware of the leaven of the Pharisees
right.
and the Sadducees because of hypocrisy, because of spiritual pride, and because of self-righteousness. So symbolically, leaven or this yeast, it represented decay and impurity. But Jesus, he uses leaven in this, he uses this that we see here, this yeast in this parable as something quite different. You know, NIV uses the word yeast in place of leaven. Now, it's this permeating quality is emphasized here to show us how powerful the influence of God is. Powerful it is. And Jesus is explaining, see, I told my friends, when I first got saved, I don't know if it was this way for you guys, but I told them that I had accepted Jesus. I told them that. I hope all of you, you've told your friends, you just don't walk up to a stranger and say, I accepted Jesus. But my friends, the people that I worked with and I hung around with, I told them I accepted Jesus. I said, I'm, and I didn't use all the Christianese saying born again because they had no idea. I just said, I accepted Jesus and I'm going to church now. Guess what happened, you guys? This is how the kingdom of God, when you mix a little bit up, and it just a little bit, and it just grows and grows and grows. Guess what would happen? Guess what would happen? They would be, when I would be in a group of guys, they would get a Playboy magazine. Anybody know what a Playboy magazine is?
Yeah.
Well, maybe some of you know. It used to be really popular, but it's a magazine with a bunch of bad pictures of women. Just kind of use your imagination. They don't have any clothes on. Okay? So, they would start to pass this around. Now, this is after I told them, I said, well, I'm going to church now. And guess what they would do, Charlie? When it would come by me, when they were passing this Playboy around, they'd say, oh no, Mike, he doesn't care about this stuff. And they'd go right over here and they'd score right by me.
Amen.
See about the kingdom of heaven?
Amen.
See how it works? It affects everything. Just because they know that I am now going to church and I'm saved and I'm a Christian, he wouldn't be aggressive, is it? How would they know that? The kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God is powerful.
That's right.
And then, when I would walk in the room, I mean the F-bomb would be dropping everywhere. They would be cursing. They'd be cursing God. And here comes Mike. I'm coming over here to do something. And I'm working. And all of a sudden, all of it's quiet. I said, don't say that.
That's right.
I just can't. Don't cuss like that in front of him. Like, oh my God, this is powerful. I didn't even say anything. I didn't even do anything. I just became a part of the kingdom, and I was seeking his righteousness. I'm going to church, and now everywhere I go, it's changing. Come on, you guys, you get it? Everywhere we go, we are a church in this community that is not doing so well. It's not doing good. In case you didn't watch the news, in case you don't know what's going on, but the kingdom of heaven is right in the middle of all of this because we are here and it's going to advance and it's going to affect everything in this city. You got to believe that. You got to understand that. Why do you think Jesus warned about worry? Why do you think he said, don't worry about all the stuff. I'm going to give that to you anyway. All you got to do is seek me first. The kingdom of God. Seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness. When you go through a little stuff like that, it says, don't turn. Don't turn because you're seeking his righteousness.
Amen.
You seek that, and God says, you don't have to worry about anything. The birds, they don't have to gather up stuff and put it in a barn. They're not even worried about tomorrow. You say, you citizens of heaven, you don't need to worry about tomorrow. You seek me first, and I'm going to give you everything you need.
Come on.
And sometimes it may be at the 11th hour, but that's good for you and me.
Amen.
But sometimes we need to have the 11th hour where God shows up, like the parting of the Red Sea, so we can see that He's truly God, and God alone that can only do those kind of miracles. Do you know a person that I'd rather have it like that? I'd rather have it to where I really saw God part a Red Sea for me instead of everything I asked for. He's just right there like, whatever you want, man. But sometimes I got to go through a test. But the kingdom of heaven is different. I got to go through some hard times. I got to be shaped and molded so God will get me where He needs me to be placed in the kingdom of heaven so that I now can be a part of the solution and not part of the problem. I don't want to be a problem for the kingdom to grow. I want to be part of the solution. How many solution people do I have in this place? The kingdom of God. So in the Bible, usually symbolizes that which is evil or unclean. But in this case, we read the two parables, it's a symbol of growth. So Jesus is showing us here that yeast permeates the whole batch of dough. This is how it happens with you and I. What a powerful influence you and I can be with the power of the Holy Ghost working through us. I want to tell you about a city was down in Central America. Some of you may have heard me tell this years ago. I've never forgotten it. There was a church in Central America that they were having a service, and they began to praise and worship. And if you've ever been like I have to Guatemala, millions and millions of people packed in this little tiny area so that the buildings all around you are just going straight up. They're like ants everywhere. The cars, the traffic, people everywhere. You think downtown LA is busy? You ought to take a trip with me like you guys have gone to Guatemala City. Nothing like it, is it? It's insane how many people are packed into that little area. So just imagine this. There's this church. They're praising and worshiping God. They got the back doors open. You know what that street looked like, a little street back there. And they have apartments on both sides of them. The glory of God falls on that place. That's the kingdom of heaven falling on us. Do you know what happened? I got to hear from a guy that was there, one of the ministers that was there. He said that people in the apartments that lived next door that weren't even in the service began to drop on their knees and weep and cry out for God to forgive them of their sins because the power of God was so powerful that heaven was exploding out of that church because a bunch of people in there got a hold of the kingdom of God. They began to praise and worship, say, Lord, great are you, Lord. Who can come against you? You are worthy of our praise. You deserve honor. You deserve glory. Instead of, I'm going to try to get to church today. I don't know if I can get to church. You don't know. I can't pay my bills. I got to work. I can't even get to church because I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. Get up. Shake yourself off. And say, Jesus is going to take care of me. I'm going to see first His kingdom, His righteousness. He's going to take care of me. You know what I do when I get sick in my body? God, you wouldn't have showed me what you're going to have me do if this was going to take me out. If what I'm feeling, what the doctors are telling me is going to take me out, it can't be.
Right.
Because you showed me, but I have vision. You showed me. I've had dreams. You've shown me what you're going to do. And I've seen myself in those pictures of what you're going to do. So God, this can't be. It can't be. So it must be that you're teaching me something. You must be. In all this, I'm going to give you thanks. Whatever I'm going through, the doctors, and whatever I'm going through in my body, I'm going to give you thanks. I'm going to praise you anyway, because you are God, and no matter what happens to me, I'm going to give you all the glory and all the praise. You know what it does, Jen? It gets me to a place. Here's what it gets me to. God, even if I die, I'm going to praise you going out. Even if I die, my life is not as important as your kingdom going forward. So, if that's what it means, if I got to die, but I don't believe that that's what He has for me. So, you know, you can get into this wrestling match with God, but you've got to get to the place where you say, God, I trust you. 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 I get the doctor's reports. I trust you. I know what it says medically. I know what it says in the science. I got my brother. My brother's been in county jail coming up on 12 years. I said, he trusts you. I trust you, God. I know you got a plan. He's been preaching in there. He's been singing in there. People have been getting saved in there. I can't look at the situation in the human mind. I better look at the glory of God that's being. By the way, the district attorney, they said they're going to release him for credit for time served.
Come on.
Because so many people are getting saved down here. He said, they don't even let me do Bible studies anymore. They say, preach to us! And he said, I'm preaching to these guys. He said, they're falling out. And he said, when they're falling out, everybody rushes over and say, Dave, what's wrong with this guy? Do we need to call a medical alert? No, that's just a Holy Ghost that knocked him down. He says, I'm okay with this. If people are getting saved and I'm preaching the gospel and this is what God had, wouldn't it be something to get to that? I'm not lifting up David, but wouldn't it be something to get to a place and this is what God has for me? Like with Paul, he said, I don't know what it was. Maybe it was his eyes, but remember the kingdom of heaven. Remember how it was? He was at a place where he said, I prayed 3 times. And God wouldn't take it from me. I'm speaking to somebody here today. I don't know who it is in this place, but God knew whatever it was with Paul, he knew that he was going to leave that on him, because then Paul got to a place, your grace is sufficient for me. And if I got to live like this the rest of my life, I'm going to preach harder, I'm going to teach harder, I'm going to keep running for you until I can't run anymore. Then he's going to give you a place. I'm talking to somebody in this world. You got to get to that place. The kingdom of heaven is much different than this kingdom.
That's right.
It's totally different. I'm ready to step into it. You ready to step into it 2024?
Yeah.
So the kingdom of God, if you could go to that. This is my last slide today. Then I want to show you this so you can capture the essence of what took place a few weeks ago down in Paris, California, right there on Clark Street. See, the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, it affects everything around you. Everything. There's nothing that God doesn't touch. And you say, well, what about all the gangs here in San Bernardino? What about all the homelessness? What about all the... Did you know that every bit of that God is touching? He touches everything.
Amen.
He's covering it all. And we're the people. We're the people that carry it. And everything that comes in contact with it changes.
Hallelujah.
Everything. Everything that comes in contact. I want to share something with you that you may not realize. A lot of the people out here, they've never come in contact with the kingdom of God. They've never. You know what I expect? I expect when we have all the people eating next door, I expect us to be able to walk up to the table. And I fully expect, it doesn't just have to happen here, you guys. It doesn't have to happen just when you come to the altar and when you pray. It's happening in jail. It's happening with a bunch of guys that know nothing about the Holy Spirit.
Preach it.
Why can't it happen out here at food distribution? Why can't it happen over here while we're feeding people? Why can't we walk up to people and we ask them, when we feel the power of the Holy Spirit, why can't we ask them, are you ready to accept Jesus? And why can't we have a, right there on the spot, accept Jesus Christ and get baptized in the Holy Ghost right there on the spot? Why not? Why not? We're a Pentecostal church.
That's right.
Why can't we walk up there and they get saved? Oh, I never heard anything like this before, Pastor. What's happening? That's the Holy Ghost all over you. I don't know what it is, but I sure like it. Can you imagine? We better sleep too long, church.
Too long.
Too long.
Yeah, too long.
We got all this, and God's saying, The kingdom of heaven is not a bubble.
That's right.
It's not just about us within. It's ready to explode and go all out into the community. So if you can get that video ready. Now when you guys watch this video, I want you to dream and imagine with me. I want you to dream about what we can do with what we have. What's in your hand? What's in your hand? What's in your hand? Think about it. Just, if you want to right now, just hold that up there right there. What's in your hand? What has God given you? What's in your hand? You don't have to pray. You don't have to be looking for anything. What's in your hand? There's something there right now to work with. So just dream with me. And I'm going to be praying that if some of you want to come out, once we get this rolling, once we get the lunches going on next door, once we get the food hub here, distribution hub, I'm praying that some of you will say, hey, I think I'll go down there. I think I'll meet some new people that don't know you, Jesus. I think the kingdom of heaven is going to roll with me, and I'm going to go down there, and I'm going to pray for some people. I'm going to love on some people. I'm going to ask people, what are their names? Where do you live? What do? How long did you live here? Well, where were you born? And instead of just falling asleep and worrying about what we're going to do tomorrow, and where's the food coming from, and my relationship is bad, and I can't do this, and I can't do that. Well, you'll stay in this, I can't do that, the rest of your life. You'll still be sitting there. And the kingdom of God is just going to be moving forward because it affects everything that it touches, and we're still sitting back waiting for something. God, you know how busy I am at work. You know my bills. You know my relationship. You know He knows. That's why He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all these things will be added unto you, so they'll come alongside you. You're not going to have to worry. You're not going to have to be stressed out. Are you ready for that video to roll it? All right, let's roll it. Drop the lights down if you could.
Today has been an amazing day. It feels so good to give back with the Concerned Family, the Melanie Youth Foundation, and City Eats. Many different organizations brought together resources, hot meals, groceries, footwear, toys, and
my dad was heavily in the community. That's how I met a lot of my friends who used to cut hair. He was the main reason why I got into doing a lot of give back, man. Just watching them give back to a lot of kids that came from this community. He was the vision that I saw for so many years, man, that made me want to give back. So when I moved to San Francisco, I moved in a community where it was like the need was real over here. And so God really told me, it's your time to do something, man. So
community was embedded in me at a very young age. And when you have community embedded in you at a young age, you have a tendency to want to get back into your community when you get older and get back. And so I felt like it was a call for me. So I started the Melanin Youth Foundation. And even though it only started with wanting to do Little Miss Melanin Pageant, I said, it's way bigger than this. I want way more for these kids. I feel like we're part of such a big, massive brand, you know, to really show up for the community. And today I got to see so many different partnerships at work together for, you know, one distinct purpose, and that's to serve the community with love, care, and appreciation, right? And sometimes we think that people can't do anything for us that we're giving to them. But it actually does give something to us. It actually gives us a sense of purpose in knowing that we're in the right place that we need to be in right now.
We have a chance to be like a powerhouse of organizations to kind of just come through and show, you know, how big we can really be and how much of an impact we can make together.
This is what I love, man. I love that everybody comes together and just do right, man. You know what I'm saying? When I pass away, that's going to happen. Pass away. I'm trying to build something for the communities and continuously take with them all over the world, man. Not just in San Francisco, but here in the Valley, in Reno Valley, you know, Ghana, Philippines.
You know, I started the Melanin Youth Foundation, and we started small, but it's going to be global.
It's going to be a big thing.
We pray that region, not reach, we pray that we join together. And we just need to be able to honor all the people who come together as unity. I know God's love for us, what he's doing in his last days.
Like, I can look a person dead in the face and say, this will happen. Like, you know, we will be a global organization.
So I want to be everywhere, man, to be realized as a good organization, you know, like, a very good organization. That's all I got.
As we close this out, I want to just do something. It's only not even a quarter till. What I'd like to do is only, not to make you feel uncomfortable, but if we could come down front and have music, Patrick, and what I'd like us all to do is what you just saw and what we talked about today about the kingdom of God advancing. Let's all join together and let's pray. Let's pray for God to impact our families, God to impact the church, God to impact the city all around us. And let's come up here in force and let's join hands together and let's pray for the city to be set free, for our families to be set free. Ooh. Let's pray for God to move. He loves our praise. He loves our worship. So let's just let it go today. And again, you know, if you feel uncomfortable coming down front, that's not the kind of pastor, it's not the kind of church we are. But if you feel like that you want to lead this charge, it's almost like we're up here and we're leading this charge, aren't we? We see and we feel and we know the hurt and we know that they need hope. We know that they need Jesus. They need the light. They need to be lifted up again. You know, I know what it is to not feel hope. And I know what it is to get hope. I know what it is to have somebody reach their arm around me and hug me and embrace me and say, I love you, Mike. I know what it is to feel that hope. But there's a lot of people out there, they don't know what that's like to feel that. They have no idea. And imagine the opportunity that God is giving us. So, as you feel led spontaneously, we're going to have some music lift up here. And if you want to just spontaneously just praise and worship, if you want to pray in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, if you want to pray in tongues, if you want, however you want to do it right now, because we're going to invite the kingdom of heaven to come strong upon us right now, because we have a mandate, and it's to go into all the world and preach the gospel, to go and make disciples out of everybody. So let's, you guys, just give us some worship. Give us some music here. And we're just going to call to heaven. We're going to have heaven to be good. Come down on this place to be able to pray that we will affect, that the kingdom of heaven will affect all these streets and our families. In Jesus' name. And if you want to lift your hands up, however you want to do it in your own style, in your own way, just be loved. Let heaven hear your voice today. Let your sound be heard. Lift up your name to
Come on.